One, two, three.
So this is where
I have two boards.
Well, no, because everyone sits here, and
they use this board.
They use this board, but there's where you're going to be, where the camera is.
Okay.
All right, and let me show you just around the corner right there is the men's room, and I'll meet you back here. ours, let us just rub off the blackboard for them.
Oh.
Things where you're going to be tripping over them. Let's see if we can just move this up entirely. This way that they have a big central round thing that goes around and there are dishes of all kinds there.
Okay.
And if you have you know, preferences or restrictions, you say, and there'll be plates that fit.
All right.
And
that's fine.
Yeah, it's sort of like if it were up to me, I would not be taking you to that restaurant. This is the tradition.
Hi.
Oh, hello.
Your speaker, I assume?
Yes.
Are you left or right-handed?
Right.
All right, just could you put this in your left pocket then?
This one here?
Yeah.
Is it here? Let's see. Okay. Or we'll just put it here.
Yeah. Just over where it says.
Yes.
Right. And then let's try to put it there. Okay. And if you'll just take the excess cord and put it in your pocket, that's just so you don't hit it by accident.
Okay. Yes.
I had a pen in my hand. Oh,
huh?
Bill?
Yes.
This is Alper Gurr. This is my
Hi. Hello.
Yeah.
Nice to meet you.
And,
how are you?
Thank you for your message. You're right. I had really only been processing that for k equals zero. That and so. Well, sounds
we'll
good.
Talk about.
right. I had a pen in my very hand when we were talking earlier, and I can't find it. So I'm going to go get another pen.
Okay.
I think I might have one.
Extra pen.
Pen.
It's green.
No, that'd be cool. Because I have so many pens at home, I just really don't want to get another one. But
oh, maybe I should write the title. That's good.
Okay. see who's all there.
Ilya's gone for a couple of weeks. Chris is gone. Some of the students are gone.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's really serious.
Yeah. Yeah.
The whole semester, Ilya and Chris.
Hello, I'm Alper.
Dick Bishop.
Nice to meet you.
So when's that?
Sometime in November.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. Do you want to make the introduction?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, we'll wait till the bell.
What is a special?
No more well.
Okay, we'll wait.
Okay. Thank you for Professor Alexander for the invitation. Thank you all for coming. Today's talk is about a classification result. This is the non-trivial part of an if and only if statement. So let me first say what the trivial part is. So let's take a circle and put a cylinder over it. And let's assume we intersect this plane with not so much tilted planes. Then I either get, again, circles or ellipses. These are all examples of central ovaloids. Central means there is a there's a point of central symmetry, which such that this thing is invariant under reflection about that point. And similarly, if you take any quadric and intersect with nearly horizontal planes, then you'll again get central ellipses, which are central ovaloids. And this theorem says that if I have an immersed surface having this cross-sectional property, then it is either a cylinder or a quadric. So let me write the theorem. Let M, I will say why this is n bigger than or equal to 4 in a second, be a complete connected smooth hypersurface with a central ovaloid property, or COP. I will give a better definition of it, but it is actually just this cross-sectional property, so COP. Then, as I said, then M is either a cylinder over a central ovaloid, or quadric. Okay, so let's go over some of these definitions here. I will give a better definition of an ovaloid, but for now, you can either think of it as a guitar pick, right? A one-dimensional ovaloid is also called an oval. So this is a guitar pick is an example of an oval, or an ellipse. Right. This oval is not central. There is no center of symmetry. Okay, but on the other hand, ellipse, which is finely isomorphic to a circle, it has a center of symmetry. So that corresponds to the center of the circle. So COP, central ovaloid property. A hypersurface has central ovaloid property if there exists at least one cross section with a hyperplane, which is an ovaloid, and all such cross sections are central. So basically, I intersect with a plane, I get an ovaloid, and all such ovaloids are central. So that is the central ovaloid property. And that's all the definitions I want to make for this theorem. So let me first describe the historical background. So where is this thing coming from? Well, it dates back to Brun, 1889. Brun took a convex body, smooth convex body, in Rn, bigger than or equal to 3, and he assumed all cross sections to be centrally symmetric. Then he concluded that that convex body is an ellipsoid. Then in 1941, Olav Yanishnikov greatly generalized that result. He took any convex body, no assumption on smoothness, and he assumed the cross sections which divide the volume in fixed proportion, not one, to be centrally symmetric. Then he again concluded that that convex body is an ellipsoid. Then in 1918, now Blaschke, in R3, he took a convex surface, and he assumed that every plane transverse or nearly tangent intersects the surface along a central loop. And then he showed that that convex surface is a quadric. The result that I'm interested, one of the results that I'm more interested today is Solomon's 2009 result. Right. He took a hypersurface of revolution. Okay, let's assume that the axis of rotation is the EN axis. So let me draw one particular hypersurface of revolution. Okay, and then he assumed.
That just means all the cross sections are spheres?
Yes, yes. And then he assumed all nearly horizontal cross sections to be centrally symmetric. Of course, if you take a horizontal one, it is just a sphere. But he also assumed nearly horizontal ones to be central hypersurfaces on M. Okay, they are all transverse cross sections. Okay. So since this is an oval, right, then near horizontal cross sections are again ovals, because this continuity of the principal curvatures, and not only that, the nearly horizontal ones are also ovals. Okay. Now, this is what Bruce calls a transverse to convex tube. So let me repeat. A transverse to convex tube is an embedded tube such that each horizontal cross section is an oval. Right, this is called the transverse to convex. So transverse to convex tube, this is it. So now if I also assume this transverse to convex tube have COP, right, and what it says that all such cross sections are central. Therefore, I have this curve of centers of horizontal cross sections. If it has COP. Okay. So let me call that as T.
I'm losing my grip again. COP. Did you write down what it meant?
No, I didn't write it down.
Would you write down COP?
Okay. Can I write it here?
Yes. Yeah.
So it does not take space. So M has.
Sorry, Jeremy. Jeremy came in late, and I was actually trying to help him, and he can't see where you're writing. Can you put it on that board, please?
Okay.
Thanks.
M has COP if, or central ovaloid property, if there exists a hyperplane H, right, such that M intersect H is an ovaloid. So let's see, M. So this is, we assumed, immersed hypersurface. Okay, that M has central ovaloid property if there exists a hyperplane H. So there exists at least one, such that M intersect H is an ovaloid. And all such ovaloid cross sections are central.
So, there just has to be one?
Yeah, I only assume there exists at least one.
Because this is immersed, so.
Yes.
All right, but there's at least one that's an embedded ovaloid.
Yes, and it is central.
And if there are any others like that, they are also.
Yes, and yes, whenever I have any other cross section which happen to be ovaloids, they are central. Yes.
What exactly is central?
There's a center of symmetry. So if there's a point such that if I reflect that hypersurface or that object about through that point, it is invariant. Okay. So this is a transverse convex tube. So what I can also do, let's suppose these are the horizontal cross sections. They are all central, right? I can actually move them horizontally, right? Such that now the curve of centers is just a line. And that object is called the rectification. So how do I obtain this? I obtain by just translating each horizontal cross section such that their centers lie on the E and axis, okay? And this is a rectification of this transverse to convex tube. All right. So, having this, Bruce in 2012 showed a theorem whose local version is this. So this is N equals 3. A transversely convex tube, with COP is either a cylinder, so a transverse, since it's a transversely convex tube, cylinder means cylinder over a central ovaloid, or a quadric. Okay? And the global version is exactly the n equals 3 case of theorem. So basically, this theorem is a generalization of Solomon's 2012 result to all dimensions bigger than or equal to 3. Okay? And today's talk is about the local version. I will give some idea of proof of how one can do it for the local version when n is bigger than or equal to 3, okay, including 3. And just a quick word of how one can go from local to global. I have my immersed surface. As I said, local looks like a transverse to convex tube because it has COP. So locally, it is a transverse to convex tube. But now, with the local version, that transverse to convex tube is either a cylinder or a quadric. So locally, that surface is either a cylinder or a quadric. But then I can expand this again, flowing by with the gradient of the height function, because the thing is complete. I can extend this tube, and that extension stops only when the tube is exactly the surface, because disconnected. Therefore, going from local to global is not anything sophisticated. It's just some technical things and one needs to deal with in differential topology. Right? Some flow box argument with this gradient of height function. So, here, okay, so this M, right? This M, I don't assume it to be convex, okay? But it is locally it's a transverse to convex tube. Therefore, and just because of the definition, it has nearly horizontal convex cross sections, right? Therefore, I am going to be using this. This allows me to use tools of convex geometry. Okay. Therefore, let me give some introduction to convex geometry. Okay. Let me define the things that I will be using in convex geometry. Okay. So convex geometry. A convex body for me is just, so this is a very particular convex body. Well, first thing, it is smooth, right? We already know solid ellipsoid is a smooth object, and also each support set is a singleton. Right? Therefore, this is an example of a strictly convex body. A strictly convex body which is smooth. But I can also have strictly convex bodies which are not smooth. Right? So if this was the origin, right, this is a strictly convex body. The boundary does not contain any line segment. And now if you were to look at the normal cone at zero, right, it is not one-dimensional. Okay, so this is not a one-dimensional cone. So, and therefore, for each normal vector here, I have one support hyperplane that supports k at zero. So this is the characterization of smoothness. A convex body is smooth if and only if, at each boundary point, the normal cone is one-dimensional, or equivalently, the support, or there exists a unique support hyperplane. So this is something not strictly convex, but not smooth. And an easy example of a non-strictly convex body is something like this. All right. Now, let me give definition of the ovaloid, okay? Now, a formal definition of an ovaloid. And again, one-dimensional ovaloid is also called an oval, is an ovaloid if there exists, if it is the boundary of a smooth convex body, K refers to dimension, therefore it has interior convex body Kn. Such that all principal curvatures are positive everywhere. Right? So this is a hypersurface, the non-vanishing Gauss curvature. Therefore, the Gauss map is a diffeomorphism, right? And here is the inverse. Okay, so for a given outer normal U, this map gives the unique point where the ovaloid makes outer normal U. Okay. So this is from Sn minus 1 to the overload. Oh, okay. All right, let me keep writing this. Okay, now, how do I describe this XKU analytically? Okay, this is the part I skipped, but let me come back to it. Now, now the objective is to get an analytical description of XKU, just not just by this description, just by inverse of the Gauss map. And this is where we're going to be using the support function. Okay, the support function has some nice properties. Okay, for example, it uniquely determines the convex body that it supports, and every sublinear function is a support function. And an important lemma is this. This HK, this support function, is differentiable at U if and only if the support set is a singleton. In which case, that X can be found by taking the gradient of H at U. Okay? Therefore, if I have a strictly convex body, right, each boundary point I can find by just taking the gradient of the support function. Okay, well, this is a strictly convex body. I mean, this boundary of a strictly convex body. Therefore, this point can be obtained by just taking the gradient of the support function. Okay, so this is how the analytical description of this point. Or if I were to write this gradient in spherical coordinates, this is what I obtain. So this is called support parameterization. Support parameterization of the ovaloid. And I will always denote that as gamma. Gamma of U. Okay. Now, a very important example of a support function is this. So if you give me n many positive numbers, AIs, okay, I can construct this function, so with those AIs. This is a sublinear function and differentiable everywhere except the origin. Right? Therefore, first of all, it's a support function because it's sublinear. And because of it's differentiable everywhere except the origin, the body that it supports, it's a strictly convex body. Okay? And how do I figure out that body? Well, if I know all boundary points, right? The body is just a convex hull. Okay? So what is the boundary points? Well, because the body is strictly convex, the boundary points are just the gradients, right? All gradients of H. And then a simple calculation, after a simple calculation, we'll get this set. Therefore, this is a support function of an origin-centered ellipsoid. Right? And now we have, here's a definition of a support function. It's from this definition, it's easy to see how the support function behaves when we apply in a rigid motion. Right? Therefore, we have the support function of all ellipsoids. Okay, so let's remember, right? It's nice that we have a h square, a square, and there's a square root. You know, one side is just in easy computation. You start with that, and you take the square, and you just find that this thing is constant on the sphere. And that's sort of easy part. The other direction, right? So let's see, I have 20 minutes, no? Yes. Okay. So let's look at the other implication, right? So it is side. So let me denote this L n minus 1, right? So this just means L of h squared is constant, right? But then h squared can be written as sum of a particular solution and a homogeneous solution, h2. Okay? For the particular solution, we choose the easiest one possible, which is going to be c over 2n minus 1 times xi squares. Right? That will make it constant on the sphere. So this part dies, and this just gives me L of h1c. And h2 is the homogeneous one. So what this implies, right, that this h2 is an eigenfunction of the Laplace-Beltrami operator. Right? We all know what they are. So this h2 has a very special form. This is a spherical harmonic of degree 2 in Rn minus 1. So it's some homogeneous polynomial, harmonic homogeneous polynomial, and its restriction is the spherical harmonic. So then h2 is of this form. Right? A is a n minus 1 times n minus 1 trace-free symmetric matrix. And this is h2. Well, because of this wise choice of h1, now I have h squared to be sum is of this form. Right? B is a symmetric matrix again, but it's also positive definite. Right? So there exists a matrix P that diagonalizes B. And with some computation, you can show that H plus or minus H supports So this is the origin-centered ellipsoid that h or minus h supports. Okay. All right, this will be very important at the end. So let me put that in a box. Okay. Here is it. Yeah, I. You can erase everything else, I think. Or maybe not. Let's keep this for now. Let's erase this. Okay, so up to now, I haven't made use of COP. So let's use that now. COP will be used to show that the transversely convex tube is a cylinder or a quadric. Okay? So this is the COP. Implies tube is either a cylinder or a quadric. Okay. So you remember this transversely convex tube I drew and also its rectification, right? So what I am going to show is that its rectification, right? After I translate all the horizontal cross sections such that the curve of center is just a line segment, I am going to show that is either a cylinder or a quadric. Okay? Because after I show that, I can actually generalize Solomon's axis lemma to show that the tube, the original tube I have, it's curve of centers is just affine. Okay? So if the transversely convex tube and its curve of centers of horizontal cross sections is affine, so then that means it is affine isomorphic to its rectification. So what I already showed, rectification is cylinder or a quadric. And of course, ovaloids are invariant under affine isomorphisms, and quadrics are, again, are close under affine isomorphisms. So it is enough to show that the rectification is either a cylinder or a quadric. Therefore, I assume that, a priori, I assume that the curve of centers lies on the n-axis. So this is the curve of centers. Let it have height between ranging from negative 1 to 1. And OK, each horizontal cross-section, OK, is just an ovaloid centered at the origin, right? And I'll denote that as OZ. Z refers to the height, OK? And then, as I said in the beginning, I can then parameterize each nearly horizontal cross section. Once I fix a tilt direction on Sn minus 2, the height and the tilt slope. Okay, so here tau is a tilt direction, and z is ranges from negative 1 to 1, and epsilon is the tilt slope. Okay. One more definition. So this is a transversely convex tube, meaning that each horizontal cross-section is an ovaloid. Therefore, I can define this function, which Solomon's and I call a transverse support function. All right, so this is defined as this. For each height z, hz is a support function of the convex hull of the horizontal cross section at height z. So this is called the transverse support function. OK. Now let's fix tau and z. Right? For each u on Sn minus 2, this is central if and only if centrix is a constant function on Sn minus 2. Okay? And this is how I'm using centrality. Okay? So therefore let me write it. So COP means, after I fix tau and z, for epsilon small enough, including at zero, right, that means the centrix is constant. Right, so that, but constancy implies that the directional derivatives, of course, are all zero for all u on Sn minus 2, and for all v, the direction. Right. Well, once I fix u and v, right, this thing is zero for all small enough epsilons, including at zero. Therefore, I take it, and this has some, this thing on left hand side has dependence on epsilon. Okay, so now if I take the derivative with respect to epsilon at zero, and change the order of differentiation, I get this thing. Okay. So with that, I am going to define another function. All right. So now this function f will depend on tau, that is the tilt slope, u, that u is exactly that u there, and z this way. This is the spherical divergence of this vector field. And it is zero, right? Because the zero is there. OK. Right. So now I have to compute what this thing is. Right? That is turns out to be quite complicated computation. But what is going to happen really? For example, for n equals 3, what my objective is, so when n is 3, right, this tau lies on the unit circle. Right? This thing, and which is also true for n bigger than or equal to 3, but it's much more complicated, for n is 3, what I will get is, so cosine theta, some expression, not depending on theta, plus sine theta, not depending something else, not depending on theta, and zero. Right? So this divergence is equal to this and zero, right? But it is true for all tau, therefore it is true for all theta. Okay. So that just means that not only the sum is zero, but these things in parentheses individually vanish. And what they are?
Are they the same?
No, they're not the same. I will write what they are now. They are the two PDEs that H satisfies, actually. OK, for that, I have to look, this, I have to look those PDEs. Okay, I have about 6 minutes. Okay, so let me write what these things here for all n bigger than or equal to 3. I have those two PDEs. The first one, again, remember h is a function of both z and u. So this is the derivative of h with respect to z. So again, these are spherical gradients and spherical applications, and this is the covariant derivative on Sn minus 2 of covariant derivative of this vector field along this direction. So this is the first PDE that H satisfies, so maybe it's one of them, I don't really recall right now. The other one is this, H okay. This is plus. H of z. Okay. So these are the two PDEs I have.
We got Laplacians of H in there and.
Yes.
And, okay.
Yes, there's Laplacians here, spherical, gradients, and this is the only thing. Well, this is gradient.
You've got a lot of dels.
Yes, this is the vector field.
They're gradients, they're Laplacians, and they're covariant derivatives.
This is covariant derivative.
Okay.
These are two our vector fields.
Just straightening out what they are.
Yes.
Okay.
And okay. So the second one looks more promising, I think. That's what we should start with. If you look at it closely, you will see that two implies this. Mm. Okay. Yeah, 3 minutes. So, right, because this is just, this thing is just a numerator of this quotient. And h is strictly positive, so everything is good. Now, I think I have to make a little huge jump here. I have 3 minutes. what 2 will serve is that I will be able to separate variables. Okay, using, so if you want to ask after the talk, I can explain a little more. But what I'm going to do is I will use Harnack inequality with some open and closed argument and the connectedness of the sphere to write H as this. Where this is only depends on the height, and H1 is the support function of the ovaloid at height 0. And that PD just turns out to be equivalent to this one. Therefore, H1 is the support function of an origin-centered ellipsoid, right? Because here I have classified all solutions of it. Then I go back to here, to this, and then I have all horizontal cross sections are just, they are just the same positive homothetic copy of the same ellipsoid. Therefore, it is affinely isomorphic to a hypersurface of revolution, which has COP, right? Then I go back to Solomon's 2009 result and conclude that it is actually a quadric hypersurface of revolution. And right on time. Thank you. No.
How does it compare with what Solomon had to do in the three-dimensional case?
Well, I mean, the overall argument sort of mimics his argument. Okay. So what is overall? Well, we first show that locally it is true, right? Locally it is either a cylinder. That's also what he does. And then from local to global, that differential topology argument has no dependence on. No, that is new. That is mine. No, that he, in his case, of course, because of his dimension that he worked, much more simpler, and he used some other thing to get the splitting. Okay, but for higher dimensions, that approach was meaningless. So this is using Harnack's inequality to get the splitting. That's something new. Okay. But he also, again, the general argument is